And so we reach the end of 2022, or as it will be known by future generations, the year what Elden Ring come out in. You know when they reboot a franchise and use the same name, they always end up having to stick the year it came out on the end, as with Sonic the Hedgehog open brackets 2006 and Doom open brackets 2016? This is going to be the opposite of that. The year 2022 will forever be known as 2022 open brackets when Elden Ring come out. Not that I want to spoil too much of what you should expect from this, the Zero Punctuation top 5, bottom 5 and blandest 5 of the preceding year, although I'll spoil one more thing. Neither God of War Ragnarok nor Sonic Frontiers appear in any of the following lists. Hopefully this time the YouTube video won't have to sit atop its comments like a squirrel being dangled over a sack of understimulated pit bulls. I'm sorry, Sam Barlow, I'm all about new approaches to interactive storytelling, but I just can't get on with this her story, immortality, watch all the videos and draw your own conclusions format. I need knobs to twiddle, and a voice telling me how well I'm twiddling them. That's why Not For Broadcast was my FMV game of choice. A bit hit and miss, but God bless it, it tried so hard it won me over in the end, and you won't find a more authentic knob twiddling experience. As always, the Game Awards showers its indie prizes on whatever passing trend gained sufficient buzz to be deemed worthy of hanging with the cool kids, even if it is just a linear hike whose core gameplay lacks any noteworthy feature besides a butthole concealing algorithm. It's Stray, a game that you can recreate at home if you happen to own a cat and a laser pointer shaped like a contextual button prompt. Hellpie is a game that actually plays pretty well with nuanced platforming mechanics and interesting varied environments. Unfortunately, it's also, in a very literal sense, gross as shit, and thus all that effort was tragically wasted. I mean, 2001 A Space Odyssey is considered one of history's greatest films, but that would not be the case if every time you turned it on, Stanley Kubrick ran out and jizzed in your eye. There's a game coming out next year inspired by Jet Set Radio called Bomb Rush Cyberfunk, and I've already declared that to be the most abusable name of any video game in history. My mind reels at the possibilities. I can get 3 swears in there easy. But until it comes out, Fartface Shitcaker will retain the title. You remember that meditative game about spaceship dismantling? I liked it, fuck you. Being one of the first big AAA releases of the year, Dying Light 2 had some shoes to fill, and proceeded to fill them with porridge and watery custard. It's such a bland, obvious open world with such a bland, obvious setting, and its zombies probably get bullied by the zombies from Left 4 Dead. Even parkour and a hang glider couldn't help it much. Felt like trying to liven up a dull work presentation by flicking the lights on and off. I feel iffy about condemning things I don't understand. Maybe there are other people with different cultural backgrounds for whom this game's story is a searing emotional rollercoaster rather than a room full of deranged circus seals banging kitchenware together. But I guess I can only ever speak from my own experience, which reliably informs me that Stranger of Paradise Anal Mantasy Squidgy Bums is a load of old piss on a freshly laundered pillow. It's a little bit Zelda, it's a little bit Soulsy, it's a little bit country, it's a little bit rock and roll. Rock and dodge roll, that is. Arf, arf. Tunic is wonderfully deliberate in its nostalgic theming and solid core gameplay integrated with a sense of unfolding mystery, and as well as third best, it's also the new holder of the Best Game Set Entirely in a Soft Play Area award. Get over it, Fall Guys. You know, I'm starting to relish Third Blandest as the sort of one true Blandest award, a game so bland it couldn't even stand out in the field of blandness. And this year it's Trek to Yomi, a game about waving a sword and moving right that limps its way through a stop and start plot before meandering to a close and disappearing from my memory until this very instant. It's happened more than once that the very last game from the year ends up in my worst list. Maybe since it's after the Game Awards, mid to late December has become, well, we've officially given up on this winning any prizes season. So yeah, the Callisto Protocol's bad. Maybe I'd have gone easier on it if it weren't so fresh in my memory, but much like ripping off the top of a dude's head so you can see his tongue wiggling about in the stump like a curious worm in a strawberry trifle, some wounds don't heal with time. Okay, hear me out. Elden Ring is a fantastically realized world and a great natural progression of the Dark Souls legacy that, rarity of rarities, I kept playing in my spare time, all 7 weekly minutes of it. But I can't in good conscience call it my game of the year because I stopped about 3 or 4 bosses before the end and never felt the desire to go back. Like many men my age, I struggle with Souls-like fatigue, but if you give generously, perhaps hope can be found for those who suffer from this debilitating social illness. I hope the next From Software game has a decent fucking ending for once. The stock expectation of the superhero game is that it should make you feel like the superhero in question. But after riding a slightly underpowered motorbike through mostly empty streets for 10 minutes before chipping away at several overly spongy health bars in yet another samey punch-up, I don't feel much like the superheroes depicted in Gotham Knights. I feel like an overworked pork butcher with an unusually long commute. Nothing like a turd so sphincter-stretchingly big its own publisher shuts it down after 6 months. Babylon's Fall is an ugly, boring, confusing tripe lollipop that already failed so hard there's little point in berating it further. It's so bad it made me retroactively hate Babylon 5 just by association. It's just fucking Deep Space Nine but set on a giant bicycle pump. In the end, there was only one game that always came to mind first when I thought of my favourites of the year. Yes, I was a little down on the whole Waname beach episode, accidental panty shot, ooh notice me senpai, no not like that you perv vibe of the plot, but Neon White's core gameplay loop is very strong and has a wonderfully breezy innovative spirit that you just don't get from games that have to drag their oversized development budgets around with them like two fat horse carcasses in a bag. Blandness is relative, really. If you took Saints Row open brackets 2022 by itself, it'd probably seem far from bland compared to most of its peers, but unfortunately it has to be weighed against the previous Saints Row games, and the moment they get dropped on the scale, Saints Row open brackets 2022 gets catapulted into a ditch. And then its dreary attempt to get back into its decades-old bed with only the tokenist attempt to refresh the linen is what pushes the dirt over it to finally bring an end to this severely mixed metaphor. Considering I gave Kark Place Tit Shaker a prize, it shouldn't surprise you to hear that I feel a bit out of touch with the kids. I cannot comprehend how anyone can look at Security Breach and see anything but a horrendously badly thought out six-lane pile-up of a game, riddled with terrible design decisions and misplaced effort, held together about as efficiently as a swarm of angry wasps in a fishing net. But the popularity of Five Nights at Freddy's mystifies me generally, so maybe I'm the wrong demographic. Maybe this is like complaining that there's no driving philosophical theme at the heart of Peppa Pig's pumpkin party.